Hello everyone, my name is Arun Kumar and I'm your instructor on the module which tells you about learning to secure your web browser. After the last module where we have decided how to select a web browser based on requirements, in this module we will learn about securing that web browser. In this module, we will first learn about a little background about web browsers. We will also see what are the types of existing web browsers. We will discuss their features and the risk associated with each of the web browser. Then we will also learn about security measures that are existing for securing these web browsers. We will see the list of various menu items that exist in the web browser, the various technologies that are used in the web browsers. To define a web browser, let me just give you a textbook definition. A web browser is a computer application used for retrieving, presenting, and transmitting information resources on the World Wide Web. It is also helpful in accessing information provided by web browsers, web servers, and other infrastructure devices within private networks or files in a file system. The most common web browsers in use are the Windows Internet Explorer, the Microsoft Edge, Mozilla Firefox, and Google Chrome. Web browsers are among the most commonly used applications on a computer. Those which come along with your computer's operating system do not normally have security features configured by default. Therefore, it is up to you to enable the security options for secure web browsing. Not doing so can support hackers to easily take over your computer, as well as allow malicious software, malware such as viruses, spyware, and adware to be downloaded. Many users fail to set up their web browser security settings by mere negligence or ignorance. On average, people who surf on the internet will click on ads and links without bothering about how secure is the website or the consequences of clicking on a malicious link. Many websites require the download of add-ons such as ActiveX. We will learn more about ActiveX in the following slides. These are just to add for additional features. These also increase the vulnerability of your web browser. Sometimes bugs in web browsers are discovered once the software has been released. Until there are patches to solve the issue, the application is vulnerable and prone to software attacks. Vulnerabilities in web browsers can help hackers to take control of your computer, steal your identity and credentials. In fact, exploiting vulnerabilities in systems is also a low-cost way of doing all of the above. So let me just take you through the popular types of web browsers. Though we have discussed these in previous module, I will still like to touch upon each one and discuss them. The first one is the Microsoft Internet Explorer. Since its first release, it has added features and technologies such as a basic table display, which aids creation of dynamic web pages, and internationalized domain names, which allow websites to have native language addresses and with non-Latin characters. This browser also has been subject to review throughout security and privacy vulnerabilities. The latest stable release is Internet Explorer 11, which is available as a free update for Windows 7 onwards. Coming on to the next browser, the Mozilla Firefox. It is a free and open source web browser derived from the Mozilla application suite and managed by Mozilla Corporation. To display web pages, Firefox uses the Gecko layout engine. There are various types of layout engines which browsers use to display web pages. Firefox uses the Gecko version, which implements most current web standards and several features that are planned to become potential additions to the standard. The latest Firefox features include tab browsing, spell checking, incremental find when you type finds the characters incrementally. It also gives you live bookmarking, a proper download manager with pause feature. There is private browsing available, and there is browsing available based on your location, which is called the location aware browsing, known as geolocation. It is based entirely on a Google service, an incorporated search system that uses Google by default in most locations. Functions can be further added through extensions. These extensions are created by third-party developers and are available through Firefox add-ons store. And there is a range of choices of features developed by third-party developers for to be added as an extension to the Mozilla Firefox. Firefox actually works on various operating systems, including Microsoft Windows, GNU Linux, Mac OS X, and another version of a Linux which is called FreeBSD, and so on and so forth. The third browser that is quite popular is the Safari web browser. It is a web browser developed purely by Apple Incorporation and included with the Mac OS X and iOS operating systems. It was first released as a public beta version on January 7, 2003 on the company's Mac OS X operating system. It became Apple's default browser beginning with Mac OS X version 10.3, Panther. Safari is also the main browser for iOS. There is also a version of Safari for the Microsoft Windows operating system, which supports Windows XP and Windows 7. The most stable release of the browser is 5.0.5, which is available as a free download for both Mac and Windows. Coming on to the next web browser, which is Google Chrome. It is a web browser developed by Google, and it uses the layout engine. Remember, the layout engine in Google Chrome is the WebKit layout engine. The name comes from the graphical user interface frame or Chrome of web browsers. In fact, there's a project which is called Chromium, which is an open source project, again developed by Google, by making part of Chrome's source code, including its V8 JavaScript engine, available to the public. It implements the same features set as Chrome, but lacks built-in automatic updates and Google branding, and also has a blue-colored logo in place of the multicolored Google logo. Seeing the next browser, which is Opera. It is a web browser and an internet suite developed by Opera Software. The browser supports common internet-related tasks, such as displaying websites, sending and receiving email messages, managing contacts, chatting on IRC, the Internet Relay Chat, downloading files via P2P agents like BitTorrent and MuTorrent, and reading web feeds, the RSS feed. It is free of charge for personal computers and mobile phones, and come on its own. That is not packed up with any desktop operating system. That means you will have to download Opera separately if you want to use it on your operating system or mobile system. It doesn't come up packed up in the operating system by default. It is well known for introducing many features later taken up by other web browsers. It runs on a variety of personal computer operating systems, including Microsoft Windows. It runs on Mac OS, Linux, and FreeBSD. It is the only commercial web browser available for Nintendo and Wii gaming systems. If you know about these gaming systems, these are gaming consoles which also require web browsers. So this is the web browser which is available commercially for Nintendo and Wii gaming system. There is another popular web browser which was very popular erstwhile, which is called the Netscape Navigator. Netscape was a general name for a series of web browsers originally produced by Netscape Communications Corporation, now a subsidiary of AOL, America Online. The original browser was once the leading browser in terms of usage share, but as a result of the first browser war, it lost virtually its entire share to Internet Explorer. Netscape was actually discontinued and support for all Netscape browsers and client products was ended on March 1, 2008. Let me just give you a few definitions to things which I mentioned in previous slide. One is the WebKit. It is a layout engine designed to allow web browsers to render web pages. For now, we can just understand that, similar to Gecko. JavaScript, I mentioned, is a prototype-based object-oriented scripting language that is dynamic and has first-class functions. IRC, I mentioned, it is Internet Relay Chat, is a form of real-time internet text messaging, or you can say synchronous conferencing. It is mainly designed for group communication and discussion forums called channels, but also allows one-to-one communication via private messages as well as chat and data transfer, including file sharing. I also mentioned BitTorrent, which is a peer-to-peer file sharing protocol used for distributing large amounts of data. Another important term that I mentioned was a web feed. It is a data format used for providing users with frequently updated content. Suppose there's a feed which you have subscribed to on a particular website, that feed will come to your browser and tell you the updated content on that website so that you can click on it, move to that website and read that content without you having to check it again and again. So this is how a web feed works. Understanding how your web browser works is very important. Sometimes enabling some web browser features may have a negative effect on the security of the system. Very often, vendors enable features by default to enhance browsing experience, but this may make the computer more open to security risk. An attacker can create a malicious web page that will install trojans or spyware, which can steal your data. A malicious website can passively compromise a system when a user clicks on the fake link. This type of attack does not actively target and attack vulnerable systems. Well, a malicious email can also be sent to victims. This is commonly known as phishing. In such cases, opening the email or attachment can compromise the system. So we will discuss some features, web browser features, and the risk that they involve. First of all, as I mentioned earlier, we will now discuss ActiveX. What is it? What kind of technology is it? And what are the risks that it involves? So ActiveX is a technology that is used by Microsoft Internet Explorer on Microsoft Windows system. ActiveX allows applications or parts of applications to be utilized by the web browser. In fact, a web page can use ActiveX components that may already reside on a Windows system, or a site may provide the component as a downloadable object. This gives extra functionality to the traditional web browsing. So if there's something that has a component which can be downloaded and executed on a system, and it may already reside on a Windows system, it gives it extra powers and functionality than the traditional web browsing scenario. But it may also introduce more severe vulnerabilities if not properly implemented. ActiveX has been plagued with various vulnerabilities and implementation issues. One problem with using ActiveX in a web browser is that it greatly increases the attack surface, or you can say attackability. So if your attack surface is very wide enough, you are prone to more attacks. And if you reduce your attack surface, the amount of attacks that you can handle or you are prone to be attacked reduces. So that is totally about having an increased attack surface. Installing any Windows application introduces the possibility of new ActiveX controls being installed. Vulnerabilities in ActiveX objects may be exploited via Internet Explorer, even if the object was never designed to be used in a web browser. So you understand there are vulnerabilities in ActiveX objects that may be exploited via the Internet Explorer, provided the object was not even designed to be used in web browser. So these are two distinct things that can be used to exploit a particular vulnerability. Many vulnerabilities with respect to ActiveX controls lead to severe impacts. In fact, often with these vulnerabilities, an attacker can take control of the computer. So be very careful while enabling and using ActiveX controls. The next thing that I want to discuss with you is Java. Java is again a object-oriented programming language that can be used to develop active content for websites. So after we have moved from static pages to dynamic pages, Java has helped the website development community to develop active content for websites. In fact, there is a Java virtual machine that is used to execute the Java code or the applet provided by the website. Some operating systems come with a JVM, while others require a JVM to be installed before Java can be used. Java applets are operating system independent. Java applets usually execute within a sandbox where the interaction with the rest of the system is limited. However, various implementations of the JVM can contain vulnerabilities that allow an applet to bypass these restrictions. You understand, there is a sandbox. I will explain what a sandbox is and what is an applet is. For now, just understand if it can go beyond this sandbox, it can explore vulnerabilities and exploit them. Signed Java applets can also bypass sandbox restrictions, but they generally prompt the user before they can execute. So always use signed Java applets. So I mentioned two terms in this particular slide, which was applet and sandbox. To understand quickly, we can say an applet is a program written in the Java programming language that can be included in an HTML page. Remember, the HTML page is written to be displayed in a web browser. Now with an applet, we can include some Java programming language and include the whole code within the HTML page. Much in the same way, like you include an image in the HTML code. The second topic that I mentioned, the word that I mentioned was sandbox. Sandbox is a security mechanism for separating running programs. It is often used to execute untested code or untrusted programs from unverified third parties, suppliers, and untrusted users. So you run that particular untrusted code program in an environment which is secure, and it helps it to separate its running from other programs. Another popular topic with web browsers is plugins. Plugins are applications intended for use in the web browser. An example of a plugin would be a plugin as an extension to display PDF, portable document file, from Adobe in the web browser. So if you enable and install that particular plugin to display PDFs in web browsers, it will help you enhance the functionality of web browser, but it may also pose some risk. In fact, Netscape developed the NPAPI standard for developing plugins, but this standard is used by multiple web browsers, including Mozilla, Firefox, and Safari. So this is a standard which is used to develop plugins for various web browsers. Plugins are also similar to ActiveX controls, but cannot be executed outside of a web browser, as compared to ActiveX, which can be executed outside the web browser and can be connected to a particular system which was not intended to be used in a web browser. You see the difference? Plugins can only be restricted and executed within the web browser. Another example of plugin is the Adobe Flash plugin. It is an example of an application that is available as a plugin, and it contains programming language to run videos which end with the .flv extension. With the help of installing this particular Adobe Flash plugin, we can run those videos and those animations. Plugins actually contain programming flaws such as buffer overflows. I'll explain what is a buffer overflow later on. Or they may also contain design flaws such as cross-domain violations, which arises when the same origin policy is not followed. So buffer overflows, anomalies where programs while writing data to a buffer overruns the buffer's boundary. So there's a buffer which has a size of say 20 bytes. The 20 bytes becomes the buffer's boundary. Buffer overflow will overrun the buffer boundary and overwrites the adjacent memory. So this is a special case of violation of memory safety. When it crosses that boundary and overwrites the adjacent memory, it can execute instructions which is not invited. So when you carry out a buffer overflow attack, you can set those instructions beyond the boundary and execute those memory instructions. Another topic which is related to browsers is cookies. Cookies are files which are placed on your system to store data for specific websites. A cookie can contain any information that a website is designed to place in it. Cookies may contain information about the sites you visited, or may even contain credentials for accessing the website. Cookies are also designed to be readable only by the website. Few cookies, which are called session cookies, are cleared when the browser is closed. And persistent cookies will remain on the browser and the computer until the specified expiration date is reached. So if a cookie is valid for 30 days, it will remain persistent on the computer till 30 days has been expired. Cookies actually can be used to uniquely identify visitors of a website, which some people consider a violation of privacy. When you visit a website with the help of cookies, the company can specifically identify you in terms of your IP address. And when they get the IP address, they can zero in on your region, your location, and the details of your ISP, which to some extent is considered a violation of privacy. If a website uses cookies for authentication, then an attacker may be able to acquire unauthorized access to their site by obtaining the cookie. So here, when I say they obtain the cookie, if the cookie is persistent in nature, it poses a higher risk than the usual session cookies, because session cookies expire after you close the web browser, but persistent cookies expire on expiration date. Therefore, they pose a bigger risk than session cookies. Another topic that relates to features of web browser and risk is JavaScript. It is also known as a ECMA script, which is a scripting language and is used to make websites more dynamic, more interactive. You see pop-ups that come on websites. You see interactive questions that come on websites. Those are all handled and created through this scripting language, which is called JavaScript. There are specifications in the JavaScript standard that restrict certain features, such as accessing local files of a system. Another similar scripting language is VBScript. But this VBScript is actually unique to Microsoft Windows Internet Explorer. Though it is similar to JavaScript, but it is not as widely used in websites because of limited compatibility with other browsers. The ability to run a scripting language such as JavaScript or VBScript allows web page authors to add a significant amount of features and thus interactivity to a web page. So with this scripting language, we can make the web page more dynamic, interactive than being static and less interactive. However, the same capability can be abused by attackers. The default configuration for most web browsers enables scripting support, which can introduce multiple vulnerabilities. When I say multiple vulnerabilities, let me discuss few of them which exploit the scripting support of web browsers. The first and foremost is the cross-site scripting, also known as XSS. not to be confused with the CSS of HTML, the cascaded site sheets. It is XSS and it is called cross-site scripting. It is a website vulnerability which allows an attacker to influence the trust relationship that you have with that site. So when you access a website, say facebook.com, you see the padlock, you see the digital certificate, you have the trust with that website. So this trust is what the attacker tries to influence and execute these vulnerabilities. This is not caused by a failure in the web browser, but by the way websites are designed. So he will insert a specially crafted code in the website and then tries to get you into an action which has malicious intent behind. The second exploit or the vulnerability I would like to tell you is cross-zoning and cross-domain vulnerabilities. Web browsers usually make use of security models to prevent script in a website from accessing data in a different domain. Vulnerabilities that infringe these security models can be used to perform actions that a site could not perform under normal conditions. The impact can be identical to a cross-site scripting vulnerability. However, if a vulnerability gives way to an attacker access the local machine zone or other protected areas, the attacker may be able to execute arbitrary commands on the vulnerable system. So when he inserts a special JavaScript code and he gets access to the web server's directory, he can change the index page, he can alter the database and insert codes which can involve actions which are malicious. The third vulnerability I want to discuss and let you know is that this scripting support through JavaScript and VBScript can also do a detection evasion. By detection evasion, I mean when you use antivirus, intrusion detection systems and intrusion prevention systems, actually they work by looking for heuristics. Heuristics means specific patterns in content. So if a known bad pattern is detected, then the appropriate actions can take place to protect the user. Yet, scripting in web pages can be used to evade such protective systems due to dynamic nature of programming languages. Let us now discuss how to secure each of those web browsers step by step. In fact, there are software features which we discuss, such as ActiveX, Java scripting, JavaScript or VBScript, add value to a web browser, but can also introduce vulnerabilities to the entire computer system. This is usually due to poor implementation, poor design, or bad configuration. For these reasons, it is vital that we all must know which browser support which features and the risk that they bring along. Web browsers are frequently updated also. Depending on your version of the software, the features and options may move, change, or update. First of all, we will now go through Microsoft Internet Explorer, which is a web browser integrated on the Windows platform. Well, ideally, you can not remove this application. It is not practical to remove this application from the system. So in addition to supporting Java scripting and other forms of active content, Internet Explorer implements ActiveX technology. While any application is potentially vulnerable to attack, it is also possible to mitigate a number of serious vulnerabilities by using a web browser that does not support ActiveX controls. Also note that using a different web browser will not remove Internet Explorer or other Windows components from the system. Other software such as email clients may use Internet Explorer. The web browser ActiveX control or the Internet Explorer HTML rendering engine. So other applications may use Internet Explorer while you may still opt to use the other web browser for browsing. So let us see some steps to disable various features in Internet Explorer. These steps may vary on different versions of Internet Explorer, but then if you get the flow of it, you will more or less understand which option to take on which version of Internet Explorer. they are more or less similar. So you should adapt these steps as appropriate. So in order to change settings for Internet Explorer, select Tools, then Internet Options. So Tools menu is on the top left hand corner. You can also find it on maybe the right hand side. So click on Tools and go to Internet Options. I think alternatively you can press Alt and plus T. It will open the Tools menu, and from the drop down click on Internet Options. When you click on Internet Options, there is a security zone. You select the security tab. On this tab you will find a section at the top that presents the various security zones that Internet Explorer uses. So for each of these zones you can select a custom level of protection. When clicking the custom level button, a second window will open. This window will allow you to select different security settings for that particular zone. The internet zone is actually where all sites firstly start off. If you want more customized control over allowed features in the zone, here you can control specific security options that apply to the current zone. For example, ActiveX can be disabled by selecting Disable for Run ActiveX Controls and Plugins tab. Default values for the high security settings can be selected by choosing High and clicking the Reset button to apply the changes. So there is this high security setting which can be selected, and you can reset the security settings to high level and click on Reset. Moving on to the next to next tab, the trusted sites with a green tick icon. The trusted zone is a security zone for sites that you consider as safe. You believe that the site is designed with adequate security in mind, and that it can be trusted not to contain malicious content. So if you want to add or remove a site from this zone, you can click on Sites. This will open another window listing the sites that you trust and enabling you to add or remove them. You may also require that only verified sites, means the HTTPS enabled sites, can be included in this zone. This gives you greater assurance that the site you're visiting in the site that it claims to be. For adding this website, click on the Sites button. The dialog box will open. You can write the site name and close the dialog box. So when you set the security level for the trusted sites zone to medium high or medium, is actually recommended. When the internet zone is set to high, you may encounter websites that do not display properly due to the security settings. This is where the trusted sites zone can help. If you trust that site and it will not contain any malicious content, you can add it to the trusted sites zone from the internet zone. Once a site is added to this zone, features such as ActiveX and Active Scripting will be enabled for the site. So essentially, you move a site from internet zone to trusted site zone, you enable those features and you trust the content and the website and the owners that this website will not carry out any malicious actions on your web browser. So the benefit is that Internet Explorer will be more secure by default, and sites can be whitelisted in the trusted site zone to gain extra functionality. Explaining whitelisted is like when you authorize some access or grant membership of a particular zone to a website so that the security settings are trusted on the website. So you whitelist it, you put those websites in a list where you trust them. Now let us discuss how you can manage cookies. Cookies, as we discussed in the previous module, these are either session cookies or persistent cookies. They can store login information, they can store browsing habit and a lot of different data with them. And we all must manage the cookies on the website. So going to the privacy tab from the internet options, it contains the settings for cookies. Cookies are actually text files placed on your computer by various sites that you visit, either directly or indirectly through ad banners. you see a particular ad and you click on that ad, and that ad takes you to the website. This is like indirectly visiting that website. And when you enter the website's name in the address bar of the browser, that is when you directly visit that website. For example, a cookie can contain any data that a site wishes to store. It is often used to track your computer as you move through a website and store information such as preferences or credentials. A good idea would be to select the advanced button and then override automatic cookie handling, then select prompt for both first and third party cookies. This way you will be prompted every time a site tries to place a cookie on your machine. If by any chance the number of cookie prompts is too high, the option always allow session cookies can be enabled. This will allow non-persistent cookies to be accepted without user interaction. And why are we doing it? Because session cookies have less risk than persistent cookies. Doing so, you can then assess the originating site, whether you wish to accept or deny the cookie, and what actions to take to allow or to block, with the option to remember the decision for all future cookies from that particular website. For example, if visiting a website causes a cookie prompt from a web domain that is associated with advertising, you may wish to click block cookie to prevent that domain from being able to set cookies on your computer for obviously privacy reasons. You can either allow or block cookies in that way. By selecting the sites button, you can control the cookie settings for specific sites. You can add or remove sites that you can change the current settings for existing ones. The bottom section of this window, as shown in the image, will specify the domain of the site and the action allow or block to take when that site wants to place a cookie on your machine. You can use the upper section of this window to change these settings. So if you add the website and you click on allow, it will allow cookies from that particular website. So this is when I was mentioning about per site privacy actions. You can configure particular websites to allow or block cookies on your system. If you do not wish to receive warning dialogues when a site attempts to set a cookie, you can use the preset privacy rules. Click the default button and then drag the slider up to high position. Some websites may fail to function properly with the high setting. In such cases, you may add the site to the list of sites for which cookies are allowed, as we described just before. Moving on to the same Internet Options tab, and there is an Advanced Privacy Settings tab. We'll click on the Advanced tab. It contains settings that apply to all of the security zones. The Enable Third-Party Browser Extensions, which is a setting in the same tab, it should be disabled for added security. So we don't want third-party browser extensions because they carry risk with them. This option actually includes toolbars and browser helper objects. Obviously, some add-ons can be useful. They can help you while browsing, but they can also violate your privacy. For example, a browser add-on may monitor your web browsing habits, which means that when you go to google.com and search for a particular t-shirt on Amazon or any other e-commerce website, it can record that browsing behavior and sell that behavior to someone to put relevant ads when you are browsing. It can even change the contents of a web page in an attempt to gather personal information. So be very careful when you enable third-party browser extensions. Also, there are internationalized domain names which can be abused to allow spoofing of a web page address. This can allow phishing attacks to be more convincing. Those who want to read more about internationalized domain names, you can search for the Homograph attack, which uses internationalized domain names to trick people into believing websites. So to protect against IDN spoofing in Internet Explorer, enable the always show encoded address. If you scroll down, up and down, you will know and see an option which says always show encoded addresses. Click on that. This will cause IDN addresses which contain alphabets from different languages to be displayed in an encoded form in the Internet Explorer address bar and status bar, which will remove the visual similarity to the spoofing target address. The next option, which is very important and should be disabled, is the play sounds in web pages. In fact, sounds in web pages are not essential to web page content. This option for Internet Explorer's ability to natively manage sounds. It will not interfere with other software such as Adobe Flash or Apple QuickTime. So if you see play sounds in web pages under multimedia, you uncheck it. Let us see how one can set default applications. Under the programs tab from the Internet Options dialog box, just before the Advanced tab, there is a Programs tab. Click on that tab. You can state your default applications for viewing websites, email messages, and other network-related tasks. Under that option, you can also choose whether to set Internet Explorer as your default web browser or not. So suppose if you have another web browser installed, you can set that Internet browser as default through Programs option. So the first settings is Internet Programs. You see a HTML editor tab. You can make the Notepad, WordPad, or Notepad++ as the default HTML editor. You can also set up Outlook as a default email provider, and so on and so forth. You can also check whether Internet Explorer is your default web browser or not. With this, we come to the end of this module. I hope we have learned enough about securing the web browser, various controls and risk associated with web browsers. I'm sure you will employ this and suggest others to securing their web browsers. Thank you and happy browsing.